Welcome to the third unit of the course Bayesian Probability Theory. My name is Wolfgang von der Linden, and I will enable you to help Captain Bayes and her crew to investigate probabilistic problems involving more than one random variable. We will come to discuss joint, conditional, and marginal probabilities, and in turn correlations. The aim of this unit is to discuss probabilistic problems from an enhanced perspective. We will learn how to include additional features into the description of an inference problem. That will allow us to update our state of knowledge based on additional information or experiments. The introduction of several random variables will seamlessly lead to the second fundamental rule in probability theory. The product rule. The question of Captain Bayes about the distribution of a sum of random variables will lead us to the central limit theorem. Finally, we will identify the rules of probability theory as the general calculus of propositions. In the previous lesson, we have discussed characteristics like mean and variance of probability distributions that rely on one variable. In this session, we extend our language to problems where more than one variable is concerned. We combine them into a tuple, which often has the properties of a vector. Each of the components of the tuple or vector describes a different feature of the experiment, or generally, of the inference problem. For example, the strange die has two features that are important for the final score, namely the number of pips on top and the color of the front side, the one facing the gambler. The front color is used as a modifier for the number of top pips, with green doubling the number and red reducing it by one. Now we can describe the outcomes of the strange die by the tuple of these two features, top pips and front color. For instance, 5 and red. In the latter case, the score is 4 points. Note that the sample space now consists of these feature pairs, and they form now the elementary events. It's all a matter of perspective. All in all, there are 6 times 2, or 12, possible such feature pairs. Note also that the score is a random variable that ranges from 0 to 12, but not all integers in this range are realized. Since a die has 4 side faces, you could also use more colors and different rules to invent your own strange die game. Next, we want to assign probabilities to the scores. Laplace colored the faces of the die green for an even and red for an odd number of pips. The die Bernoulli and Laplace are using for the Trinautic tournament is strange because the pips are arranged in an unusual way. We illustrate this by a net of the cube. The yellow framed face represents the top of the die, showing the number 1 in this example. The 4 faces surrounding it are the possible candidates for the sides pointing towards the gambler. Note that there are in total 6 times 4, or 24, possible geometric realizations of the die experiment if you take the side face orientation also into account. In order to assign probabilities, we count the geometric realizations that lead to a defined feature pair of top pips and front color. In this example, with 1 pip on top, we count 3 realizations for the green and 1 realization for the red modifier. Similarly, we proceed with the other values of the top pips. 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and obtain the following table. According to the principle of indifference, all geometric realizations are equally probable, and therefore the classical assignment of probability for a pair, top pips front color, is given by the number of favorable geometric realizations, which are the numbers in the table, divided by the total number of geometric realizations, which is 24. The probability for the pair 6 and red is therefore 3 divided by 24, resulting in 12.5%. That leads to the following table of joint probabilities. From the table of joint probabilities for the feature pairs, we can easily construct another representation, namely the pair, score, and front color. If the front color is green, the score is obtained by multiplying the top pips by 2. Likewise, if the front color is red, the score is obtained by reducing the top pips by 1. These tables represent different joint probabilities. Needless to say that joint probabilities can also be defined for more than just two propositions or variables, like P of A, B, and C, and so on. Now that we know the joint probabilities, there are different aspects of the inference problem that we can address. In case of the strange die, we could ask the question, what is the probability for a particular score, for example 6 points, given the front side is green? Such an object is called conditional probability, since one feature, here the color, is fixed. We use a vertical line to separate the random variables or events of interest from the fixed conditions. In terms of propositions, the notation is shorter. P of A given B describes the probability for A given B is true for sure. When we examine the probabilities for all values of a random variable score, given that the color is green, we obtain the conditional probability distribution. We want to illustrate this concept on the strange die and compute the conditional probability. Note that the sample space has shrunk, as only the elements with green front face are considered. The elements that we consider are the same as those in the joint probability, therefore the probability ratios between them have to be the same. Consequently, the conditional probability is proportional to the joint one. In other words, only the normalization Z has changed, which is now given by summing the joint probability over the score values, resulting in the depicted table. Similarly, we obtain the conditional probabilities for the score given the front color is red. Now we change the perspective into the opposite. Instead of fixing a feature, we simply don't care about it. For example, we might want to know the probability for the score being 4, say, irrespective of the front color. Or we are interested in the probability that the front color is green, irrespective of the number of scores. We use again the table of joint probabilities. We consider the joint feature pair, score and color, as elementary event. For fixed score S, the events with the same score but different colors are exclusive, and therefore the simplified sum rule applies. On the other hand, from Boolean algebra we know that the argument of the left-hand side turns out to be the score. In our example, we obtain the probability of a certain score just by summing the rows and noting the resulting probability on the right margin. Similarly, we obtain the marginal probabilities for the colors by summing the columns of the table. Thereby, we find P red is equal to P green is equal to 1/2. Do you see any easy explanation for this result? This brings us to the marginalization rule in its most general form. We consider any set of complete and exclusive propositions P sub I, which means they form a non-overlapping partition of the sample space. Then we obtain the generalized marginalization rule. The importance of this rule cannot be overestimated. Again, a generalization to more than two variables is obvious. Now we come to the second fundamental rule of probability theory, the product rule. We combine the formula we obtain for the conditional probability and the formula for the marginal probability and obtain, written differently, we obtain the famous product rule, which has the general form. Note that A and B do not have to be elementary events or be assigned to random variables, but can be arbitrary propositions. The product rule enables us to change the perspective of an inference problem, since it is the formula that links assumptions, propositions behind the conditional bar, with open questions, propositions before the conditional bar. We will see in Unit 6 how this product rule enables us to swap assumption and open question to tackle inverse problems. Note that for uncorrelated propositions A and B, the product rule simplifies, like the probability for rain and rolling 6 pips on a die is equal to the product of the two probabilities. It was a long and winding road in the history of science until this general form could be proven rigorously. It is applicable to the most general definition of probability as a measure for the truth of a proposition. Then, probability theory can be considered as calculus of propositions and is a seamless generalization of Boolean algebra to partial truth. The only axioms this calculus is based on are consistency, which means one gets the same result no matter along which path the calculation is performed, and continuity with respect to small changes of parameters. If there are more than two propositions, there are several choices of propositions for which we can compute the probabilities conditional on the others, corresponding to different perspectives of the problem. Note, there is no such thing as an unconditional probability. It always relies on assumptions. Like the die is perfectly symmetric, the throw guarantees a chaotic trajectory, the players are not cheating, the die has six faces, it will never land on an edge or corner, and so on. We combine all these assumptions into the so-called background information. We do not always write the background information explicitly, but keep in mind that it has to be fixed and cannot be changed during the calculations to remain consistent. Like you cannot expect the same outcome of an experiment when you alter its setup. If some assumptions may be altered, new informations, looking at different aspects, then we will write them explicitly behind the conditional bar. As a matter of fact, the background information is nothing but a proposition, and one is immediately prompted to move it in front of the conditional bar. That allows us to check our assumptions, like, what is the probability that a coin is fair if it lands heads up 10 times in a row? But you have to be patient. We will cover this topic only in a later unit. So far, we have discussed three different aspects of probability distributions: the joint, the marginal, and the conditional probability. Now, we want to turn to the computation of mean values for these cases. In The Adventure of Captain Bass, the question was raised about the average score obtained in the strange die game. One way to compute it is to define a function s of t and c that evaluates the score from the number of top pips and the front color. Then the average score is given by the sum of this function times the joint probability. Alternatively, we could use the marginal probability mass function for the score, which we computed already, resulting in 4.5. Finally, we can address Laplace's question concerning the average score he gets, assuming he always sees the green front face. In this case, the answer is given by the mean value of the conditional probability distribution, resulting in 6 points on average. Quite similarly, we obtain the average conditional on red to be 3. Oftentimes, the conditional probabilities and their means are more easily accessible than the joint probabilities, in which case we can employ a useful expression for the total mean. Applied to the strange die, we then find in agreement with the previous result. All of the above considerations can easily be generalized to other problems with two random variables. The variance is in principle just a special case of the previous discussion, but due to its importance, we will give the result explicitly. We compute it for the score of the strange die, for which we need the marginal probability mass function, resulting in 8.9. Another important object in the analysis of random variables, or generally in inference problems, is the covariance, which allows to identify correlations between different features A and B. It shows whether on average an increase of A above its mean is associated with an increase of B above its mean, or whether it is associated with a decrease of B below its mean. For example, we could test whether in a population a person's weight is correlated or anticorrelated with his or her height. If fluctuations of one feature are independent of fluctuations of the other feature, then the covariance is zero. That implies, according to its definition, that the mean of a product is the product of the means. And therefore, the joint probability factorizes into the product of the marginal probabilities. Now we can apply the covariance to examine Pascal's notes on the sailing deviations. Since we have measured data, we can estimate the joint probabilities by the relative frequencies. As discussed, along with the sample variance, we have to correct for a bias due to the use of the sample mean value. The covariance of the sailing direction and the sailing deviation of Pascal's nodes is 0.13, indicating a correlation between the sailing direction and the deviation, which can be considered as a hint for the presence of an ocean drift. All what we have discussed so far can readily be generalized to more than two features, variables, or rather propositions. In the adventure, Bass was wondering how the sum of the strange dice scores of her crew might be distributed. This brings us to the central limit theorem. The scores of the crew members are actually random variables. Let us be flexible as to the size of the crew and just denote it by n. The individual random variables have special properties. They are independently and identically distributed, which is abbreviated by IID. What does that mean? Well, identical means that all random variables have the same probability mass function, characterized by its mean and variance. Independent means uncorrelated and implies that the covariance between different variables is zero. Now we turn to the average total score. That is what we are really interested in. We call it arithmetic mean, although the objects are random variables. It should be obvious that t is also a random variable. For the mean of t, we obtain from the previous slide and the linearity property that it is identical to the mean of the distribution of the individual terms. The variance of t is given by the variance of the distribution of the individual terms divided by n. Even more thrilling is what Captain Bass wanted to know, namely the detailed form of the distribution of t. The central limit theorem states that the probability distribution of t, being the mean of n independently and identically distributed random variables, approaches the Gaussian distribution for n going to infinity with mean and variance given before. So the distribution of t universally approaches a distribution called Gaussian, irrespective of the shape of the probability mass function of the individual terms. What is a Gaussian? The Gaussian distribution is one of the most important and ubiquitous distributions in probability theory. It is given by the following formula, parameterized by mean and variance. It has the shape of a bell and is therefore often called bell curve or normal distribution. The limit n going to infinity itself is actually not very relevant for most real-world applications. But already for moderately large n, the distribution is confusingly similar to a Gaussian. So Captain Bass will find that the distribution of the average score of her crew in the strange die game will look like a Gaussian. This concludes the third unit. Investigate the sums of random variables and the central limit theorem using the interactive simulations. Feel free to ask questions in the forum and feel encouraged to test your knowledge in the quiz.